I feel about Universal's new The Mummy? Meh. But would I see the next Dark Universe movie? Yes, I would. Why would I agree to such a thing? Well, I see potential here. And quite frankly, I don't think Alex Kurtzman is going to direct any more of these movies. So problem solved. In fact, I'd take him off the whole Dark Universe in general, which he's supposed to be running, but he also ran the Star Trek reboot, and we all saw how that turned out. And he didn't even get this cinematic universe off to a good start this time. So it's weird. I don't understand why somebody would look at how the Star Trek reboot turned out and go, I want one of those for myself. But as for the cinematic universe that Universal is trying to build here, there are fun teases throughout the film, and it ends with a lot of promises, some of them pretty exciting. But, well, I can't go into it too much because I don't want to give away spoilers. We're going to have a spoiler review for sure. But let me just say, I was waiting for the to see if there was an end credit scene, and there isn't. I mean, are we building a cinematic universe or not here? I couldn't believe there wasn't an end credit sequence. I mean, talk about a movie that needed an end credit sequence to distract you, all right, from the film itself. But while I was waiting, there were two guys seated next to me, and they were debating as to whether or not the movie may be teased too much with other characters. And one said, you know what, I liked it, but they should save it. They should save it for another movie or for the next movie. And I don't agree. I think they didn't have nearly enough crossover with other gods and monsters that are going to be a part of the Universal's Dark Universe. Because when they had that element in the film, that's when the film worked best. The film also worked very well when it lets loose and embraces the absurdity of gods and monsters clashing with modern society. Tom Cruise is very funny here. Jake Johnson, the same wonderful scene stealer he was in Jurassic World. And even Russell Crowe. I really liked what Russell Crowe did here, to be honest with you. All of them were very funny, and they seem to not only be committed to the Dark Universe, but are having a good time making the movie. So I wish that they had been allowed to do even more. Now, Tom Cruise does the most heavy lifting here, and along with Leonardo DiCaprio and Denzel Washington, all three are one of the few movie stars left that always elevate the material. Like when Tom Cruise is on screen, it's just electric. He's a movie star for a reason. And by the way, I was going to add Tom Hanks to that list, but he couldn't elevate the Da Vinci Code movies. Oh, sorry, Tom. It's also nice to see Tom Cruise be a little mischievous here. We haven't seen that from him in a while, even though that's what first made him famous. I'd also like to add, though, that it's very rare to see Tom Cruise get tripped up by his own ego, which is definitely what happens here. In fact, I don't believe that's happened since Interview with a Vampire, and I guess both have the same train wreck kind of appeal. But I think his desire to play this character in this cinematic universe blinded him to some obvious problems with the script and directing. And he brought in Christopher McQuarrie to do a rewrite on the script, his go-to guy, along with Doug Liman, who both served him quite well. If only he could have gotten one of them to direct. And maybe that's where the movie does work, you know, but they couldn't save it, even though I think they make it not a bad movie. And I also believe that the ending of the film is very far out there, and he wrongly believed, Tom Cruise, that he could sell it all by himself. I was like, you needed some help here, Tom. It didn't quite work out. As for the two actresses in the film, they both do nice work, very nice work, in fact, but I was surprised how antiquated their roles were for female characters. They're really just Betty and Veronica to Tom Cruise's Archie. And if you're seeing this movie for Sofia Boutella, you're going to both be very pleased and very upset. We will talk about it in the spoiler review. I was kind of angry, actually, when the movie ended in that regard. But also, speaking of Sofia Boutella, this is a surprisingly sexual movie. With Wonder Woman, I feel bad having to bring this up again so soon after warning people about Wonder Woman, but at least Wonder Woman was innocent. Here, for example, I'll just give you an example. You have Tom Cruise naked in bed, he gets pretty close to fully naked in this movie. He's like, damn it, I paid my trainer a lot of money and I have had a lot of plastic surgery and I'm gonna show it off. And I'm like, well, it did work, but I don't know if this is the movie to do it in, Tom. But anyway, he's in bed with a half-naked woman straddling him, and it's all very kinky, and I was very aware that there was like an 8-year-old boy sitting in front of me in the theater, and I was like, And I was thinking about it, and I was like, how did this happen? Because, you know, there were like know, they would, like, for instance, Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, which I made as a parallel to Wonder Woman. I said, you know, people were asking me, oh, do you think I can take my child? And I was like, it's tough to tell, but I was like, if you think they could watch Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, which has quite a bit of flirting in it with Elsa at the beginning of the movie, they should be fine here, right? But we never saw Indy and Elsa in bed together, both naked, right? I mean, like, that's where I think they kind of crossed the line. And I would attribute this to Game of Thrones. I'm calling it the Game of Thrones effect, where these movies feel they need to compete with cable blockbusters, right? But they still want to be PG-13 for maximum box office. And you can't have it both ways. Honestly, the movie should have just gone R. I mean, Logan made a lot of money, certainly as much money as Tom Cruise movies make. So, you know, let him have an R-rated franchise and just go not only for the sexiness, but also for the gore and the horror. I mean, I would just say go for it. All right, so Alex Kurtzman, what exactly did he do wrong? You know, sometimes it's just a general malaise with the director. You're like, you just didn't do a good job. But I know what he did wrong. So what's wrong with this movie is that it has no soul. Let's bring up the Dark Universe logo again. This movie is as corporate and as devoid as creativity as this logo. I mean, if you look at the old monster movies that these are based on that made monster movies famous way back in the 1930s when they didn't have all the visual effects that they have today, it's just amazing the artistry that's on display there. For instance, I recently rewatched Frankenstein, directed by James Whale, and the opening shot is just so mesmerizing of this road leading from a graveyard with a hangman's noose, or the construct that holds it up, and it looks like a painting. Now, it probably was a painting because, you know, back then they would shoot these things on sound stages and they would literally paint them. But with the black and, you know, the backgrounds, but with the black and white cinematography and the way it was framed and the smoke coming in and the way the figure entered, the mysterious figure, I mean, it's just beautiful. It's hypnotic. And there was no artistry in this movie. I mean, it was very slick. It was very cold and calculated. Again, corporate. You know, I think that they were missing that flair. And sometimes in the movie, when the mummy was just starting to come back to life, they almost got there. Like, you were like, okay, that's pretty cool. I like the way the mummy moved early on in the movie. That was really neat. And they had some atmosphere, but it just wasn't enough. I'm just surprised that anybody would I mean, I wonder if Alex Kurtzman watched the old monster movies, because I don't see how he could have if he missed the artistry that's so clearly on display. They're beautifully made movies, and they hold up because of that. Now, Bill Condon is going to direct the next Dark Universe movie, The Bride of Frankenstein, 2019. And he's going to fix it because he knows what he's doing. He knows James Whale. He got a start with Gods and Monsters, telling James Whale's story. And you can see with Beauty and the Beast and even Twilight that he knows how to make a very beautiful picture. So he's going to deliver. He knows what to do. And that's the thing. You're going to want to see Bride of Frankenstein. So you might as well see where it all started with this movie, right? In fact, I cannot tell you not to see this movie because while it's definitely a very mixed bag, you've never seen anything like this before, both the good and the bad. It's a popcorn film. I mean, if this didn't come out in the summer, it would be in a lot of trouble. I would liken it to Transformers for the monster set. But I would also say sometimes you're like, wow, this is like Underworld, those kinds of movies with a bigger budget and a movie star in it. Like if Tom Cruise was like, you know what, I'll make in the next Underworld movie, you'd be like, this is very weird, but I cannot away. And that's kind of, I think, what this film was like a lot of the time. So my advice to you is don't expect much, look to the future, and laugh away, both with the movie and at it. So that's my review of The Mummy. I look forward to hearing your thoughts down below. Don't spoil anything. Some of the surprises are the only thing kind of worth seeing this movie for. So stay tuned for the spoiler review. And again, I look forward to continuing the conversation down below. And you can check out some more videos right now.